All right, if everybody wants to find a seat, we're getting ready for our next presentation. Okay, cool, guys. Hi, I'm Luke Doyle. I'm from West Virginia University. I'm a first-year grad student, and I'm helping out this year at the Fab Lab. And we're also live streaming right now. What's it called again? On the 92nd Street Y. So that's pretty cool that we've started doing that this year. So today we have Adam Chau. He's a ceramic designer who got his BFA from Maine College of Art and was also received a Master's of Design in Industrial Design. He's currently living in Portchester, New York, and manages adult educational programming, and also works with exhibitions at the Clay Arts Center. Adam is also maintaining a private fab lab, and today he will be demonstrating with this CNC router, which was so much fun getting down here, and it's not heavy at all. So without further ado, here's Adam with his digital calligraphy demonstration.
Hi, guys. Oh, is this on? Okay, it's on, right? The mic. So let's see the screen. I do want to give a special thanks to Iconic CNC, who has generally sponsored me and given me this machine. I could not have done it without them. If you are interested in this machine, they do have an educational package, and you can talk to me later about it. I want to run through before the hands-on demo part about why I do what I do, because I think it's important to lay a foundation of how artists can start to get into digital technology. So the project I'm working with is digital calligraphy, and it aims to explore the role of the machine made and the handmade by intersecting qualities of the hand, accident, intuition, inconsistency, with those of digital computation, which is precision, efficiency, and serial production. I look to find a way to find a hybrid practice where characteristics of both worlds allow for a new genre for artisans to research and practice. And I think the best way to explain this, you guys are visual people, I did make a 2x2 graph that is a chronology of process. The x-axis is the manufactured, so something that can start, go, and stop on its own. And at the bottom, it's the handmade. And then to the left, it's the digital that's things in binary that have to go through a process to be translated for a machine to go. And on the right is analog, so things that is direct manipulation. So if we start on the lower right-hand quadrant, there are a couple of processes. I wasn't specific to ceramics, but we can take ceramics. Here I have potters throwing, right? They use their hand with an analog tool. They use wheels. You can slab build with a rolling pin. If you go up, and this is a chronology, even though it's a 2x2, you go up and you can see that you start using templates like jiggers and jollies, but it's still in the analog realm, but it's manufactured. The hand is out of that. You're using molds, you're using things that aren't so direct. Now we go to the upper left-hand quadrant, and we see things go into the CNC machine, 3D printing, Jacquard looms. Things like that, you're taking the analog out of it, you're starting to get into binary code, and everything is kind of a few steps into the digital. Now, what I think is super interesting is the bottom left-hand quadrant. What would something look like that's digital and handmade? I think this is a really weird quadrant, and I'm really interested in exploring it. So people in this field, or manipulating things like this, I have a few people. One is Dr. Katie Bunnell. She founded Autonomatic, which is in Falmouth University. It's a design cluster. She's no longer there, but this project was made there. She took a Mason plate, photographed it, and then manipulated it on CAM software in order to create a new pattern. So you can see the comparison between the old Maiolica with the new decal print. It's kind of the same layout, but it's used in a contemporary way. Another person, not a ceramicist, Drummer Masterton, was also at Autonomatic in Falmouth. When you CNC something, if you want to plane something out at an even level so your stock is even, usually the machine thinks for you and makes a very precise or constant plane. What he's been doing is he's been blocking off sections where you can get really interesting results in surfaces just by blocking it off. He's taking the computer thinking out of it, and he's saying, no, I want this part to be milled first, and then I want a different design afterward. I think it's also important, I didn't make all of the lectures here, but I wanted to run through the four processes of digital manufacturing, which is one, your input. 3D scanning, your input would be your subject. CAD is computer-aided design, so something that you 3D model in. And CAM, computer-aided machining, the thing that translates the 3D model into the toolpath. And then finally, output, which is the actual machine. So in my case, I use a CNC machine. And most of the examples today and yesterday focus on software. Even though they're using physical objects, they're kind of manipulating software, things like that. And early on, I had the idea of not manipulating the software and hacking the hardware. These are physical machines that can be, you know, hacked into and manipulated. So if you're not familiar, which you should be, if you saw other lectures, this is a CNC machine. This is a larger one. It has an XYZ axis. And they come with, this is a milling machine, so they come with bits. These bits are very precise. This usually machines go with a 0.002 millimeter tolerance, and these bits are equally the same precision. My idea was, what if these weren't precise? What if we handmade these tools? What would happen on the machine? So early on, I was carving into clay with handmade tools. Now, I was getting a very interesting surface, however, it wasn't functional. Case in point, I made porcelain tools, put it on a CNC machine, and made plates. However, I really wanted to bring the function into it because I was a potter. I was a BFA student in ceramics before I went into industrial design, and I really wanted to weave that in. So I came up with the idea of adding handmade brushes. Right? So this on the left was the first test of it. I really liked the outcome. The bottom right was the first series I did in black underglaze. They are 3D printed ferrules. And if you don't know what a ferrule is, it's when you have a brush, there's the brush stick, and then there's the hairs in the middle part. That metal part is called a ferrule. And I needed to make that because the CNC machine has a collet, and I needed to create an adapter piece into that. So that's why it has that funny shape. Now the CNC machine, if you're milling it, spins at a very high rate in order to carve into material. And since I'm brushing, I don't need to do that. So I have to alter the G or the M code. So I just put a standard M code library that the iconic CNC machine uses. And on the bottom, I have, when I make my CAM toolpath, you can see the 1, 2, 3, 4th line. It says MO3 at the end. That's what turns the spindle on. So I just go into that code and I change it to MO5, which stops the spindle. Pretty easy. You don't have to, you know, it's not magic. You just look into the library, see what you need, and alter it. So because I'm going to go back a little bit, these plates were the first tests and I liked it. However, I didn't feel like it was rooted in any kind of continuum of the ceramic history. So I researched and found these amazing, amazing Kosametsuke porcelain wares, which were made in the 18th century by China for the Japanese market. And attached to this was the idea of mushikue, which is translates to the moth-eaten edge. And it was a desired inconsistency in the cobalt line. So I really wanted to marry the inconsistency of a brushstroke made by the CNC with this historical root. So, you know, I made porcelain. Oh, it's really blown out. I'm sorry for that. But you can see examples on this table. I made moths. It's the same toolpath over and over, but because I'm using different handmade brushes, I get a different result, which I think is fantastic. Now, as far as the form goes, I do use Rhino. I use Rhino 4 and Rhino Cam in order to get the machine. toolpath, but I also use it to make the molds. I use a pie molding technique, which I'll show you in a couple of minutes. And the one on the left is both the toolpath and the laser cutting toolpath together. In the middle is the laser cut MDF. I use, for this particular plate, I use a 1/4 inch MDF, and for the mods, I do use an 1/8 inch. And then, it's pie molded into this form, and then here is, they're on the table, but anyone on the internet can see it is a little blown out, but I have been making portraits. And same toolpath, again, within a 0.002 millimeter of a tolerance, so it is doing the exact same thing, exact same movement every single time, but because I'm unstandardizing these tool bits, I get a radically different result. So I think I did pretty much blow through that because I really wanted to show you what the capabilities are for this. So I'm gonna move this aside. Can I just close this computer? Yep, I can, okay, great. So, and I don't know if the camera can really see the table, but here's my mold. So this is called a pie molding technique, and it's what bakers use to make pie shells. What you do is get your board, you put your base down. Can people see that? And then you put your slab over it. And I use a slab that's a little bit under, it's about 1/8 inch, or in between 1/8 and 1/4 inch. And I press it down lightly to get the internal ledge. And then what I do, what's important, is that if you saw the template, there is a gap between the internal template and the outside template, and that's so a clay slab can go into it. If it was the same, I wouldn't be able, it would just be pushing in like a cookie cutter. So I line it up and I actually take a rolling pin and press it down. And what bakers will do, I'm the son of a baker, so it's all about baking. What bakers will do is put another pie tin over it, cut with a needle tool, which is missing. Anyone see a needle tool? Oh, yes. Always missing my tools. And then I will just trace around it, and this gets me, I can work in multiples, which I like to do because it's all about the surface, so I want to create consistency in the form first. And you can see all of these videos, anyone on the internet at the 92nd Street Y right now, you can look up my website at adamchau.com or just go on Instagram. I put all of the videos on Instagram. So I take this off, really easy. And then take this one off, and it's a little weird what I do. Can everyone see this? Mildly? Okay. Put it over. Flip it. Then get the top of the plate. So all of my work I make upside down first. You see that? And then, and carefully, this clay is a little sticky, but it should release. I use MDF because it's a porous material and you can laser cut it, and it absorbs a little bit of moisture, just enough to pop off if the clay is not too wet, which it is. So that's how I get that. Do you guys have any questions? I can just roll on, but if you have any questions, I can also work and talk about it. So this is the machine, and mine at home is about half the size of this, but anything will work. It's the same software developer, so it takes my code very well. It is a little jerky because their movement settings are a little bit off, so it will like jerk around a little bit. Mine's a little bit smoother of an arc. So let's have some kitchen magic and get my bone dry plates. So what I do is I make these, dry them out, I put a commercial glaze over it, run it through the CNC, and I once fire, because who has time to disc these days. This machine, I love this machine because you don't have to hook it up to a computer. I just put a USB, I put the code on the USB, all of my files are on there. Put it in first and then turn it on. Make sure the e-stop is off. Yep. And then I am going to, this has a safety feature that I turned off. You should be running it with this closed, but we'll open that. I did put paper down. This is for milling, so what happens is they give you these grooves to secure wood on it, but I don't need to. First thing it's going to do is find the 00. And there's a brush in there already. The collet is a quarter of an inch, but there's this particular model also takes half inch tools. So what I have to do, because it's kind of a, you know, it will do whatever I say, but it also won't do what it doesn't know, I have to have the brush dip into cobalt. So I do program that as well. I have to model the reservoir and the toolpath that it needs in order to pick up the cobalt. These are the ferals, and I buy so much animal hair, it's crazy. Because they do different things, right? This one is deer tail, I've got muskrat, I've got caribou is really cool, bear, this one doesn't pick up that too much, but I buy these at tackle shops because I don't want to buy a pelt of this, right? I just want little bits. So fly fishing stores carry little bits of hair for like a couple of bucks. And it's fantastic. If you want to make your own brushes, maybe not even for the CNC, go to a tackle shop. So right now I've got moose hair in here. I have my little reservoir. It's just a little dish. I'm going to put cobalt in it. And I used to do the cobalt first and then glaze next. However, I find that my cobalt was smudging. So a workaround for that was using brushing medium. If you don't know about that, it's amazing. It is a powdered glue that you can use, and you can use it with underglaze or stains if you have wash, like ceramic washes that you like to use, but they smudge too much, use a brushing medium, and it just makes it stick to the pot. So I don't really measure, if you do use it, you have to use between 10 and 25% of it. But I just do cobalt and water. As much as I like to, I don't really measure. It does need to mix in. So I also, when I program this machine, I know exactly where it's going for the coordinates. I do measure out where it's going so I can set the origin. The origin has to be in the middle of the reservoir with the cobalt. And I put this in. Then I put my plate in. And this is really the longest part, is setting it up. It's about 17 seconds to actually run. So it'll ask you, it's a really cool, just like simple waterproof controller. It'll ask you to select your file. And I've got all of my files on here onto this USB. I'm going to go to the right one. And then it'll ask you to program your coordinates. So I'm going to manually do it. And at home, I'm usually pretty precise about getting in the middle of the reservoir because it does affect it. And then the relationship between the reservoir and the actual plate is key also, because if you move it a little down, your facial features will be a little high up. So I think that's about right. And then you do have to set your z-axis, because every single time you have different models, you have different plates of different heights,
you also have to make sure that your skim line doesn't go above where the trigger is, because then you'll air out.
That's about good, I think.
So you are going to set the zero, and that resets all the coordinates. And then this machine asks for speed levels. Mine is just a standard speed. So this is where you'll see on a video on Instagram that I have, you will see a fluid line. This is a little jerky. So it is a tiny bit different. I just hit enter. It's like pressing print. And this machine also has to think a little bit. I think what happens is it's, whoa. That's faster than yesterday. So you see how it's kind of jerking around? That's because I imported a G-code that is custom fit to my machine, not this one. And then because this is moose hair, it's very thick hair. It doesn't hold a lot of cobalt. I'll show you the result. It's very sparse cobalt, and I'll switch it with a tool that holds a lot. And that's it. Well, no, that's not it. But. So, and then it goes back to home. Unfortunately, this machine, you have to set the origin point every single time. Mine, which is in general eye carver, will keep the origin point. So as long as the machine is on, and say I have got like 12 plates, it'll keep that reservoir point. I have to reset it every single time for this one, though. So you can see that there's, it's a little like a ghost portrait right here, which I really like. Sometimes I like it to be really literal. Sometimes I like it to be a little more abstract. So let's put another one in. So you just slide it up like that. And I did, I modeled this in Rhino, exported it as a STL, and just printed it in PLA. No questions so far? Yeah? No, so I have had it dip back into the reservoir. I feel like sometimes it gets a little too abstracted and messy and blotty. So I really try, when I program it, to do it in one shot. So you'll see that was moose hair. I'm going to use caribou next, which is one of my favorites. Has anyone seen caribou hair? It's really cool. So I just inserted it and tightening it on. I'm going to do the exact same thing. So I'm going to select my file. Set the origin point. So you can see it's a thicker line now. So you can see is radically different than the first. And what I really like about this is you could see the brush go up from the Z-axis to move to another part, but it still traced the parts. And I really like that, like Megumi's talk, it's a reference to X, Y, and Z, which I really like. Now that's it, I could go on with, I made like 4 plates. I can do another one, but yeah, yes. Mm-hmm. So I knew that the collet size, I'll show you the collet, if I could get this off. There you go. So I don't know how to take this off, but the collet right here is 1/4 inch. So what I had to do when I made my adapter piece, my ferrule, is I had to make this little part, which is 1/2 inch, be 1/4 inch. And then I knew that the hair, I wanted it thicker. I didn't want it to be 1/4 inch tube. I thought of that first, but I needed it to be a little bulkier. It's 1/2 inch tube attached to 1/4 inch adapter piece. So what do you want to see, guys? I've got fox, I've got deer. Fox? Okay. Fox is actually really bad because it's fox tail, and if you've ever seen one, they're waterproof. So it doesn't pick up the cobalt. So it's interesting. Fox tail, other mediums, not really. It's anything that's like water-based, it kind of dries immediately. It doesn't pick up the material. The best is actually deer tail because it's hollow and it just kind of holds everything. I've got hundreds of these brushes at home. I'm actually at the Northern Clay Center at a tipping point. There's a reception tonight at 6:00, and you can see a whole wall of the work with a big dish of like 100 brushes just piled up. Okay, let's get a plate. I will also mention that in using cobalt for so long, the brush picks up the lightest material and the heavy particles of the cobalt go down, so I do have to replace it once in a while and stir it up. If you do use the brushing medium, it does suspend it a little bit. Also important to note, if you don't use CNC machines, the 00 is usually, it's at its origin, however, that's on the back left, which means you're working in the bottom right-hand quadrant. I use Rhino, but any software, it is the bottom right. And it's nicely put down on here, but you have to remember when you model your stuff and export it using CAM, it should be on the bottom right. Otherwise, it'll think it's like behind here and the machine will try to go back. I have. You can see some videos of me trying to do cups and Yunomis. It's a little harder because the gantry height is so limiting. This one is about 7 inches. The ferrule adds a little bit of Z-axis shortage. So I need to use smaller brushes if I have a high piece. So if the gantry was like a foot tall, I could totally do higher things on its side. But with this machine, I'm kind of limited, but I like being restricted a little bit to two-dimensional plates. So again, this one's really kind of like calligraphy. See, it's like the brush is always different. I'm always surprised, which makes me continue this project. If I knew what was going to come out every single time, I would be so bored and want to move on. But I'm always surprised to a point. I do know like the properties of certain brushes will give me this kind of stroke or that kind of stroke. But yeah, depending even on how much cobalt you put in the reservoir, if it was really high, it would pick up more material. If it was really low, it'll have a lower amount. Or the cobalt to water ratio, you'll get a more watercolor line versus a really deep color. When the cobalt goes up, it mats out the glaze and it almost turns purple sometimes. Anything else?
Have you ever used
the
human hair?
Is what?
Human hair.
I have tried human hair that's on the horizon. I don't want to divulge too much. I'm trying. It's an experiment. Yeah?
So you mentioned you shut off the spinning.
Mm-hmm.
Is it possible to control the spin
now
with like a slow spin?
You could. That would be going into the code and setting. You could. No, yeah, it's really easy, actually. You would both do it in the Rhino cam. You can set the spindle setting of how many revolutions per minute. So you could say one revolution per minute would be really slow, or you can go into the code and set that yourself. You should spindle speed, blah, 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 and do that. Yep, possible. For me, I don't think that's super necessary because I feel like if I did that, because these brushes are organic hair, they have a little bit of a flow to that. So if it was spinning, I wouldn't kind of get the quality that I wanted. It wouldn't really be a face. You would get like a swirly kind of effect. Anyone else? No, that's it. Oh, so in the beginning, I started out with carving the clay. I started out with thinking that I could carve up, manipulate clay by taking handmade porcelain pieces and carving into it, but it just wasn't functional. I really wanted the idea that these are plates. These are things that you can have in a domestic space and really like live with. Anything else? Well, that's it. I mean, I have a few more. I'll just keep on doing it, and you can stop by and have a closer look if you want. Thanks, guys.